Welcome. Myself Ramya Shri, Department of Physics from Veerashaiva College, Ballari. Babinet compensator. Babinet compensator is an optical device which is used to produce desirable path difference between ordinary ray and extraordinary ray. Construction of the babinet compensator. It is made up of two wedge-shaped quartz sections ABC and ADC having equal acute angles. So one of the quartz wedge is fixed and the other can be displaced along their plane of contact with the help of a micrometer screw arrangement. So the optic axis of the first section is parallel to the refracting edge AB, and the optic axis of the second edge ADC is perpendicular to the refracting edge. So let a plane polarized light be incident normally on the refracting edge AB of the compensator. So it splits into the two rays, extraordinary ray and ordinary ray, which are parallel and perpendicular to the refracting edge AB respectively. So since the crystal is a quartz positive uniaxial crystal, E ray travels slower than the O ray in the first session. So when these rays enter the second session, E ray becomes O ray. Since the optic axis in the second session is in a direction normal to that in the first prism, similarly, the ordinary ray becomes the extraordinary ray. So thus two rays exchange their velocities in passing from one session to the other section. So the net effect of one section cancels the effect of the other. If T1 and T2 be the thickness of the first and the second section respectively, mu O and mu E be the refractive indices of the quartz for ordinary and extraordinary ray respectively, then the path difference between E ray and O ray in the first session, that is ABC, is given by delta 1. Similarly, the path difference between E ray and O ray in the second session, that is ADC, is given by delta 2. So the net path difference between two rays after they emerge out from the crystal is given by delta is equal to delta 1 plus delta 2. Substituting the values of delta 1 and delta 2 and simplifying, we get the net path difference delta is equal to mu E minus mu O into T1 minus T2. So we know that the phase difference is given by 2 pi by lambda times the path difference. So that the net phase difference can be written as 2 pi by lambda mu E minus mu O into the difference of the thickness T1 minus T2. So thus, any desired value of phase difference can be obtained between ordinary ray and the extraordinary ray. Fresnel's explanation of optical activity. So Fresnel assumed that when a plane polarized light incident when a plane polarized light enters the crystal along the optic axis, they are resolved into two circularly polarized vibrations rotating in opposite direction, one along clockwise and another along anti-clockwise, the same angular frequency. So in a crystal like calcite, these two circularly polarized vectors or the vibrations travel with the same angular velocity. So in this figure, OR is the circularly polarized vector rotating in clockwise direction, OL is the circularly polarized vector rotating in anticlockwise direction. So the resultant of these two vectors OR and OL is along OA. So according to Fresnel, when a linearly polarized light enters a crystal like calcite along the optic axis, the circularly polarized vibration rotating in opposite direction having the same velocity. So the resultant of these two vectors will be along OK. So therefore, crystals like calcite, they do not rotate the plane of vibration. So in case of quartz crystal, when a linearly polarized light enters the crystal, the component having the clockwise rotation travels faster than the anticlockwise component. Here, delta is the angle when the components emerge out of the crystal. The resultant of these two vectors, OL and OR, is along OD. So this is in case of quartz crystal. The analytical treatment of Fresnel's explanation. So let us assume that when a linearly polarized light is incident normally on the quartz plate, which is cut perpendicular to the optic axis. So let the vibration of the incident light is represented by y is equal to a cos omega t. So on entering the crystal, these vibrations are broken up into two equal and opposite circular vibrations, so which are represented by x1 and y1, so which is clockwise circular polarization, and x2 and y2, which is anti-clockwise circular polarization. These circular components travel through the crystal with the different velocities. So when they emerge out from the crystal, there is a phase difference of delta between them. So in case of a quartz crystal, which is a right-handed optically active crystal, the clockwise component travels faster. So the circular component are represented by x1 and y1, which is for clockwise component, and x2, y2, which is anti-clockwise component. So the resulting displacement along two axes, that is x and y, are represented by x is equal to x1 plus x2 and y is equal to y1 plus y2. Substituting the values of x1 and x2 and simplifying this equation using this formula, we get the resultant displacement along x-axis given by x is equal to a cos omega t plus delta by 2 sine delta by 2, which is equation 1. Similarly, the resultant displacement along y-axis can be obtained by substituting the formulas and simplifying this equation using this formula. We get the resultant displacement along y-axis a cos omega t plus delta by 2 cos delta by 2, which is equation. The resultant vibration along these two axes, x and y axis, having the same phase. So therefore, the resultant vibration is plane polarized and it makes an angle delta by 2 with that of original direction. Thus, plane of polarization is rotated through an angle of delta by 2 on passing through the crystal. So dividing equation 1 by equation 2, we get x by y is equal to tan of delta by 2. Suppose mu r and mu l be the refractive indices of quartz in the direction of optic axis for clockwise and anti-clockwise circularly polarized light, and d be the thickness of the crystal plate, then phase difference is given by 2 pi by lambda mu l minus mu r into d. So hence the plane of polarization is rotated through an angle theta, then theta is equal to delta by 2 pi, which is equal to pi by lambda into mu l minus mu r into d. This is in case of quartz crystal, which is a right-handed optically active crystal. If suppose the crystal is left-handed optically active crystal, then delta by 2 is equal to pi by lambda mu r minus mu l into d. Lorentz half-shade polarimeter. So polarimeter is an instrument which is used for determining the optical rotation of a solution. So the polarimeter consists of a monochromatic source S, which is placed at a focal point of a convex lens L. So just after the convex lens, there is a Nicol prism N1 which acts as a polarizer. So polarizer is a crystal that produces the plain polarized light. So here HSD is a half shaded device which divides the field of polarized light emerging out of the Nicole prism N1 into two halves, generally which are of unequal brightness. G is a glass tube in which optically active solution is filled. So the light, after passing through this tube, it is allowed to fall on the analyzer prism N2. So analyzer is a crystal that detects or analyzes the plain polarized light. So this analyzer can be rotated about the axis of the tube. After the Nicol prism, there is a telescope. Working of the polarimeter. So let us suppose that if there is no half shaded device between the Nicol prism and the glass tube, that is the polarizer and the glass tube. So the position of the analyzer is so adjusted that the field of the view is dark when the tube is empty. The position of the analyzer is noted through the circular scale. So now if the tube is filled with optically active solution and set it in its proper position. So the optically active solution rotates the plane of polarization of light emerging out of the polarizer by some angle. So the light is transmitted by the analyzer and the field of view of telescope becomes bright. If suppose the now the analyzer is rotated by some angle so that the field of view of telescope again becomes dark. So this will happen only when the analyzer is rotated by some angle by which plane of polarization of light is rotated by optically active solution. So the position of analyzer is again noted through the circular scale. The difference of these two readings will give the angle of rotation of polarization. So when the analyzer is rotated for the total darkness, so it is difficult to find the exact position for which we get complete darkness. So to overcome this difficulty, half shaded device is introduced between the polarizer and glass tube. So that half shaded device is a consists of two semicircular plates ACB and ADB, which is made up of quartz. So both are cemented together. Polarization is along OP, and passing through the glass, half of the vibration will remain along OP. So but on passing through a quartz, half of this vibration will split into two components, that is ordinary and the extraordinary. So we know that the extraordinary components are always parallel to the optic axis and ordinary components are always perpendicular to the optic axis. So ordinary ray travels faster in quartz, and hence O component will be, that is ordinary component will be along OD instead of OC. Thus OA and OD components will combine to form a resultant vibration along OQ. So now if the principal plane of analyzing Nicol is parallel to OP, the light will pass only through half of the glass. So hence glass half will be bright and the quartz half will be dark. So similarly, if the principal plane of analyzer is along AOB, then both half will be bright. So on the other hand, if the principal plane of the analyzer is along DOC, then both half will be equally dark. Hence, by using this half shaded device, we can measure the angle of rotation more specific rotation. So for a given wavelength of light at a given temperature, specific rotation is defined as rotation produced by 1 decimeter long column of the solution containing 1 gram of optically active material per cc of a solution. So specific rotation is given by S is equal to T theta by L into C. So where theta is the angle of rotation, L is the length of the glass tube, and C is the concentration of the solution. Thank you.